the notice on exporter. If exporter is not a producer, again, we have that knowledge of relevant facts situation. If exporter is not the producer of NAFTA goods, the exporting party must have adequate knowledge of whether the good qualifies. Because exporter, he did not, he or she or it did not handle the products, so it may be a shortcut to go to the exporter, goes to the producer and say, hey producer, can you help me fill this out? Or in fact, can you fill this out for me? Provide me supporting documentation and sign it. Based on that, exporter signs it and gives it to the importer. That's, I think that's good enough. Because the exporter must have, the producer, the manufacturer, the farm grower, they must have the actual knowledge of what really was taking place to make that product qualified for North American Free Trade Agreement. So, quiz break. Which of the following is not true about the NAFTA Certificate of Origin? Certificate of Origin ANA says that must be signed by exporter or exporter's authorized agent, remember those buzzwords, having knowledge of relevant facts. We're looking for the one that's not true. This one is true. So we move on. The certificate must be in possession of the importer at the time of preferential treatment is claimed unless waived by the port director pursuant to that 19 CFR 181.22D. Remember that section that we discussed in the context of centers of excellence and expertise. So it must be executed by exporter. It must be in possession of importer. So that's true also. Because if importer does not have it, no claim can be made. A certificate which is photocopied, faxed, or scanned on a computer disk is acceptable. So that's generally true, especially in a world of modernized world. So now we live in the ACE world, automated commercial environment, where you can upload it to the server, right? So this is good as long as the essential elements are there, including the signature, of course. Because you know what happens, right? If you made a false statement, you subject automatically yourself to the criminal penalty, among other things, right? I believe there is a 5-year for making a false statement, 5-year prison's maximum for making a false statement to the federal officer, which would be customs. There is also an addition, so that's 18 U.S.C. 1001. There is also aiders and abettors. Then we have a criminal statute for mail and wire fraud. So if you send something by U.S. mail or by, let's say, by internet, right? Upload stuff, email stuff. You're also subject. And I believe mail fraud has a 20-year sentence, criminal sentence. So that's significant stuff. And for government to expect you to take responsibility and for you to be cognizant of the seriousness of this stuff, it must come with a TIF attached. And one way to have the TIF attached is the execution. As long as you executed and you made a true copy, true fax, or true scan without any alterations, that can be acceptable, not only from the point of view of NAFTA, but from the point of view as evidence that you made that claim falsely or not falsely, depending on the circumstances. So, C is good. D, a certificate is required for each importation on which NAFTA is claimed, but does not need to accompany each shipment. There is even a requirement, there is even an option for what's called, we'll cover that in a bit, blanket certificate of origin, meaning that So goods are continuously produced. They're produced in the same form and fashion. So why make every time the certificate of origin is just too burdensome for the paperwork is concerned? So you make one blanket certificate, good for 1 year, sign it, place it on a shelf, place it on file, and make copies of it for each entry packet. So does not need to accompany shipment, yes, but you have to have it as a part of the entry packet. A producer who is not the importer, who is not the exporter, I'm sorry, may prepare and sign certificate, relieving the exporter of his obligation. A producer who is not the exporter may prepare and sign the certificate. Well, producer who is not an exporter may choose to prepare and provide it to exporter, but in no case this will relieve the exporter of his or her obligation to prepare a certificate. So it can be as add-on, but it cannot be used instead of. So if this is viewed as an add-on, yes, according to the directive, right, 2810. But here it is done in a vacuum. So it seems like a producer who is not an exporter is the ultimate party preparing certificate of origin. That's not good enough, because the obligation, the regulation, the law says clearly it is the exporter's responsibility. So it's not true, because this answer choice suggests that exporter is not going to prepare one. Producer is the ultimate and only party who is doing that. It's a good question, because it also gives you a possibility to read in between the lines what they mean, right? Because in a way, on one hand, in one document, right, Customs and Border Protection says, yes, export producers may choose to prepare, right? But it's still the exporter's ultimate responsibility. Exporter can take it and based on producer statement, sign it. This way, there is a good wave, there is due diligence, but still, producer who is not an exporting party still cannot be the last person in this chain of documentation requirement. It is the exporter who has CBP form 434 obligation.